go. We are going one round with former champion TJ Dillashaw as he prepares for another title bout against champion Aljamain Sterling in Abu Dhabi. What's up, TJ? How you doing, my man?
Doing great, man. Doing really good out here, actually, in Abu Dhabi, getting ready to hit a practice with Ludwig, Felipe, and Coach Wombles.
TJ, you're back, dog. It's been a minute. You know, the last fight against Cory Sandhagen, I thought that you showed a lot of heart and determination because it seemed as though he was a bit something new, right? He was kind of fighting in the way that you fight. You showed a lot of heart to get that victory. Then the injury. How have you been able to stay positive over the course of the recovery time, knowing that you were in line for a championship fight like this?
Yeah, man, that fight was tough, man. I had to gut through some serious stuff in that fight, you know. Blowing my knee out the end of that first round, I didn't realize how bad I blew it out until I tried walking back out that second round. It was tough, man, having to bite down your mouthpiece and just say, screw it, and go after it, you know, because that fight would have looked a lot more like the first round if I would have stayed healthy. You know, I couldn't return my takedowns to the mat. So it was something I just kind of had to have a horrible second round, get back in the corner. My coaches wake me up and say, screw it. We just got to go. And, you know, a testament to my mental toughness and just getting a job done against a very good opponent, a guy that I knew that was tough. You know, I knew going into that fight that it was going to be a dogfight because Sandhagen's good, man. He's long. He's tricky. He's technical. Threw some stuff at me I hadn't seen yet, and to get through that one was a big testament to just mental toughness and having that wrestling background to be able to bite down and go through anything.
You know, TJ, you mentioned the mental toughness that it takes to, you know, grit through the injury and fighting somebody as talented as Cory Sandhagen, and you said he threw some things at you that were a little different for you. This is another long layoff for you because you're recovering from that injury. Aljamain Sterling is a totally different fighter than Cory Sandhagen. What have you been doing to prepare for his style, especially after watching the way he used the takedowns to beat Piotr Jan in his last fight?
Yeah, I mean, I think this matchup is great for me. You know, the style that I have to be able to fight. I mean, I'm so well-rounded. I'm actually the better wrestler. I wasn't really impressed with his shots, you know, to get those takedowns. He had to take 22 of them to get two, right? So those odds aren't that great. But he was so desperate and persistent in getting them that it helped out for him, right? But, I mean, to be honest, man, I'm not feeling the threat. I'm going to get out there and do what I do best and show him what D1 wrestling is all about.
You know, Dillashaw, when you were rocking and rolling and you were the man, Aljamain Sterling was around, but he was young in the game. So watching him ascend to the championship, becoming the man in the weight class in your time away, what are your thoughts on Aljamain Sterling? Because it seems as though he harbors a lot of ill will towards you. Do you feel the same or no?
No, not really. You know, I try not to hold much ill will when I fight, man. I know I fight better when I'm just relaxed, having fun. And so I learned something early in my career after I had like a grudge match with Dominic Cruz that I fight better just letting things go, right? And so you got to find your own mental stability on where you perform best. And me, it's getting out there showing off and having a good time. So I don't hold a grudge on nothing. I feel like he's got to build something up. I think he's already building excuses of why I'm going to beat him and trying to play that mental warfare, but it ain't going to work with me.
Well, you know, TJ, you know, you have worn the strap twice. This has been a long journey for you, not necessarily in years, just the things you've had to endure from an adversity standpoint to get back here. What will that feeling be if you are able to come up with the win and be champion once again? How will you feel about that, and what will it mean to you?
Yeah, man, when I'm champion, it's going to be great. You know, like I never left. You know, I never lost my belt to this weight class. Yeah, I was stripped, but I never actually physically lost it. And people forget, man, people forget how dominant I was because I hadn't been in there. I hadn't performing. You know, I hold a lot of records at the bantamweight division. And just because of me, the time off, you know, they forget. And so I'm about to remind them all of who the best is, who the best pound for pound is, and that 135 pound goat, I'm coming for it.
It's a very difficult weight class, the bantamweight, 135 division. But I want to kind of pivot away from the fight in Abu Dhabi and ask you a little bit about the landscape, especially on your contemporaries, right? Watching Dominic Cruz a guy that you two are considered the two best bantamweights of all time, watching as his career seems to be doing this, how have you continued to ascend and stay at the top, and how hard is it for you to watch your contemporary start to fall a little bit as you're still pursuing championships?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely hard, you know, but it gives me more confidence that I'm doing the right things to continue to get better, that, you know, I'm aging like a fine wine and continue to stay on top. And I've been on top of this sport. I've been on top of this sport since 2014. I've been on the top, right? If I'm in this sport, I'm going to be at top. I'm going to be fighting for the belt. I'm going to be fighting for those top spots. So since 2014, I've been there, and I'll always be there. So if I decide to fight, I'm in the top. I'm the champ. And now I'm back to prove it.
You know, you mentioned, you know, this division and being on the top of it. I think when you look at bantamweight right now, it's not only a weak division, but it's extremely talented. When you think about the Aljamain Sterlings, the Piotr Jans, Cory Sandhagens, Chito Vera, obviously, and even a guy like Sean O'Malley, when you look at this division and what it presents to you going forward, how exciting is it to still be one of the marquee fighters in what could truly be the most talented division in the entire UFC?
Yeah, man. I mean, it's super exciting, right? To see what the weight class has done and how it's evolved. And it's always been super exciting weight class, right? I've always had guys getting out there and banging, high energy, lots of technique, tons of knockouts, you know? So it's a weight class that's always been very entertaining. And now we got the personalities to back it up. And the list is endless for me to defend my belt against once I get it back.
You know, TJ, I remember when you won the belt the first time. We shared a card together, you and I, and nobody thought that you could do what you did to Hannon Barral at the time. And you have
turned
out to be one of the greatest bantamweights of all time. Train hard, my friend. Train smart over there in Abu Dhabi. I will see you next week as you try to become a three-time UFC bantamweight champion. A lot of times people call you 1B to Dominic Cruz's 1A. You win this championship again. I think that there will be no question as to who is the greatest bantamweight of all time. Enjoy your time there, and I'll see you next week. TJ, thanks for joining us.
Appreciate
it, boys.
Best
of luck, brother.
And thank you very much.
Thank you for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.